Every August, about 1 million Torontonians crowd the streets of Greektown to attend the Greek community's Taste of the Danforth Festival. Over the course of a hot summer weekend, citizens of one of the most ethnically diverse cities in the world mix peacefully to sample Greek food and music in what has become a model celebration of multiculturalism and Greek civic pride. But it wasn't always this way. And it wasn't all that long ago when Toronto's good citizens also took to the streets in search of Greeks, but with a very different intent. When war broke out in 1914, Greece was politically divided over the issue of involvement. Greece's King Constantine supported Germany's Kaiser Wilhelm and wanted Greece to remain neutral. Prime Minister Eleftherios Venizelos, on the other hand, wanted Greece to enter the war in support of Britain. As a result, Greece remained officially neutral. But Greece's neutrality during the war created a problem for the Canadian government. When the war began, immigrants to Canada from countries officially at war with Britain were labeled resident alien enemies and put into internment camps. But because Greece was neutral, Greeks in Canada were free to live and work in the country. At the same time, because Greece's neutral status could change at any time, the Canadian Expeditionary Force was reluctant to recruit Greeks who might suddenly become alien enemies should Greece enter the war on the side of Germany. But even after conscription became law, many Greeks refused to fill out enlistment papers.
As the war dragged on and the anomalous situation of the Greeks kept them out of the war effort, they became an eyesore to returned veterans who saw these men of military age who were not pulling their duty. Greeks came then to exemplify the slacker being men who basically dodged the draft.
Compounding problems for Toronto's first Greeks was their high-visibility occupations. In 1918, the Greek community in Toronto numbered approximately 3,000 people, only about one-half of 1% of Toronto's population at the time. But while the community was small, Greeks owned and operated roughly 35% of the city's cafes and restaurants, most of its shoeshine parlors, and many of the fruit and vegetable and grocery stores. Like the Greek community itself, many of the businesses were located not along Danforth Avenue, as today, but in an area further south, bounded by Jarvis Street, Yonge Street, Carleton, and Dundas Streets. Unfortunately, this also happened to be where the large community of returned veterans lived. Of the approximately 630,000 Canadians who joined the Expeditionary Force, roughly 100,000 were from the Greater Toronto Area. 1 in 7 would not return. Of those that did, they found the city busier, dirtier, and more crowded than they had left it. They also found a society that didn't quite know what to do with them.
There were women and men flooding into the war plants in the cities. A city like Toronto would probably have seen 75,000 new jobs created in munitions plants. If you're a returned veteran coming back to Toronto in, say, 1918, you look around you and you see all your friends are dead or in hospital or shell-shocked, your family's living in difficult conditions because you, the breadwinner, have been overseas and there hasn't been that much money coming in. Your pension would depend on how badly you were wounded. You probably had a lot of bureaucracy to go through to get it, and you may not have been paid anything as yet. So not only are you wounded, crowded, unhappy, seeing your friends die, seeing people get rich at home, seeing aliens get jobs because they tend not to enlist, and it's the British-born and the Anglo-Canadians who are doing the fighting, everything just compounds to make you frustrated, make you ready to explode.
One last piece of the puzzle fell into place. The Great War's Veterans Association called for their first national congress to begin on Friday, August the 2nd. In anticipation of this meeting, close to 10,000 veterans from around the country descended on Toronto. Veterans in ever larger numbers were now present in the city, and they had on their mind their grievances.
As far as you're concerned, all those guys are slackers. They're people that should have never been let in and should now be deported. It's time to clean up this mess. I think that's very much the attitude.
In the sweltering heat of that August civic holiday weekend, their resentment and anger would finally explode. For the next 4 days, more than 50,000 Torontonians rampaged through the downtown streets, destroying every Greek restaurant they could find. It would turn into one of the worst anti-Greek riots in the world.
I'm standing at the corner of Yonge, College, and Carlton Streets, one of the most vibrant and energetic intersections in downtown Toronto. In 1918, this was one of the hearts of working-class Toronto. More importantly, this was also the center of the life of the returned World War I veterans. Right around the corner on College Street was the Convalescent Hospital, where many of the injured veterans received medical treatment. In addition, there were cheap boarding houses and rooming houses all along here where the veterans lived. There were also cheap eateries, most of them owned and operated by Greeks, where the veterans frequented. But in short, this was their neighborhood. And as we will see, they would defend it. The heat wave that had been scorching the city for much of the summer had broken. Nonetheless, things were going to get hotter in the city of Toronto. At about 7:30 on that evening, a returned veteran, a French-Canadian named Claude Claudonnet, who lived just up the street here on Dundonald Street in a boarding house. He was a returned veteran who had lost one arm and a leg in the First World War. He had spent most of that day drinking. We were told that he was a little worse for liquor, when at about 7:30, he made his way down Yonge Street, heading toward his favorite diner, the White City Cafe, located at 433 Yonge Street. The White City Cafe was owned by a Greek immigrant named Paul Letros. Like many Greeks, he came to Toronto after first being in the U.S., and in partnership with Peter Spiel, he opened the White City Cafe. As was customary back then, and indeed even now, most of the people who worked in the cafe were fellow immigrants from Greece, or they're in fact his family members.
They had a lot of veterans coming into their restaurant, and they used to treat them to coffee, and they used to treat them to meals. And this one particular fellow was involved. He was a steady customer, but he came in one day and he was drunk. And he sat down and he got abusive with one of the waiters. And he wanted to fight, and so another waiter got together with this particular waiter. They just put him out in the street and left him, and they called the police. And the policeman came and took him away and put him in jail. And he was in jail overnight, and the next day he came back to the restaurant. He apologized to my dad and everybody else. But in the meantime, people had heard about it, friends of his, and the rumors started.
When Claudonnet failed to return home on Thursday evening, his roommates thought little of it. After all, it was not uncommon for him to stay out after a night of drinking. When, however, he didn't return home on Thursday, they began to get worried. Rumors began to circulate amongst the community of returned veterans that Claudonnet had been beaten and was in hospital. They blamed the, quote, filthy Greeks for the act.
It's a very different Canada than it is today. Racism isn't accepted today. It isn't what you find in public discourse. It exists. Racism in 1918 is public discourse. People speak it unashamedly. They talk about wops and Polacks and kikes and chinks, and it's accepted.
There was a tide of anti-immigrant sentiments, and this tide was expressed in very physical, in very real terms.
And so you get into a situation where a veteran, a man who's lost his leg in battle, a certified hero, goes into a restaurant, which happens to be run by Greeks, and he gets thrown out. That's all you need.
At about 6 p.m. on that Friday evening, veterans began to gather. By 7 o'clock, there were close to 600 men here. They then moved down the street to the White City Cafe, where they confronted Paul Letros. They began to chant slogans outside demanding justice. Letros, realizing that the situation was becoming tense, told his customers to leave the restaurant immediately. And he told his waitstaff to hide in the back while he talked to the crowd. He came out front, told them what had happened, and that in fact, Claudinet had returned to the restaurant and had apologized for his behavior the other evening. But none of that meant anything to the veterans, who were now angry and looking for someone to blame. A fusillade of rocks and bricks smashed through the windows and doors of the restaurants. The mob then entered inside, destroying every scrap of furniture, every counter, and then looted the kitchen. The night of violence against the Greek community had just begun. The violence that had taken place Friday evening at the White City Cafe was a spontaneous outburst, fueled by the anger of Claude Claudinet's friends at what had happened to him and mob mentality. What would happen for the remainder of Friday evening, however, was anything but spontaneous. The mob dissipated from the White City Cafe and 2 hours later reconvened here at the Normal School. Not only that, but a leadership emerged. Men took to these very steps and addressed the crowd. They talked about what their grievances were, and more importantly, they made clear what their intent was and who their target was. As they told their fellow soldiers, tonight they wanted justice. Tonight they would go hunting Greeks. They formulated a plan. From here, they would set off on a journey that would lead to the destruction of every Greek business in the city. Their first target was going to be the White City Lunch. This was the sister store to the White City Cafe and was co-owned by Paul Letros. About 2,000 strong, they set off from here at the Normal School to the far northwest corner of the city, to the corner of Bloor and Dufferin, where the night of hunting Greeks would begin.
According to a newspaper report, by this time, the crowd was not only growing in size, but in ferocity. Paul Spiel, a veteran of the Balkan Wars and co-owner of the White City Lunch, was not at home when the mob arrived. Startled by the crash of plate glass windows, his wife went downstairs to investigate. By that time, the men were breaking up everything they could lay their hands on.
I asked them why they were acting like this. I am a Canadian and my children are Canadians. They said they didn't care and that they would kill me if I didn't get out of the way.
Mrs. Spiel was struck by the men and needed a doctor's attention. The mob, according to plan, now headed east towards Yonge Street. Their next stop was the Marathon Cafe at 822 Yonge Street. The Marathon was owned by Emmanuel Vassilion, a solid supporter of the war effort. Both he and his cafe were well known to the soldiers. Bricks smashed in the front window while looters and vandals turned the interior to rubble. They lit up cigars from the smashed display cases and set off again down Yonge Street.
The mob, now over 6,000 strong, having destroyed every Greek business along Bloor Street and Yonge Street at Yonge and Bloor, now started moving south. Their next target was the Star Cafe. It began with rocks being pelted through the windows, and then the mob entered the restaurant and once more destroyed it. Regrouping out in front, they then began to move south on Yonge Street, now being joined by looters. The crowd was swelling to close to 10,000. They were in search of more Greeks to hunt, and their goal was to destroy every Greek restaurant along Yonge Street. And still, the police were not present. Their next target was the Vandamme Cafe, owned by Harry Carolus. They turned next to the Colonial Lunch Cafe, owned by Chris Bazos.
My dad came to Canada in 1912. 6 years prior to that, he had arrived from Greece to Chicago. And then in 1912, he and his brother crossed the border at Windsor and came to Toronto and opened up a restaurant called the Colonial Lunch. My dad didn't get married until 1923, so there was a 5-year gap right there. And I didn't know anything about the riots. They kept to themselves, and I think one of the reasons my dad never mentioned it to me was maybe he wanted me to experience this in my own time and not have any preconceived notions based on what happened to him.
The Colonial Lunch Cafe met with the full wrath of the crowd and was completely destroyed. They turned next to the Superior Lunch Cafe. The Superior Lunch Cafe is still in business, and in fact is the only one of the Greek businesses destroyed that is still in operation today. Here, however, something different happened. This period was left largely untouched, and here's why. A member of the crowd threw a stone through the window of the store. Charging out was the man who was working the cash register that evening. He was a veteran of the First World War who was still, in fact, a member of the Canadian Expeditionary Force. And he confronted the crowd, and he said, "I'm a veteran. I have shed blood for Canada. Why are you doing this?" The crowd, quote, touched by his words, left the superior alone. Until the next evening, however, when the mob returned during the rioting on Saturday night, and the superior as well was completely destroyed. Through most of the Friday evening, while the riot was in progress, the police stood passively by, spectators to the destruction. However, eventually, Acting Chief Constable Samuel Dixon decided that the police must make a stand. And so he called up the day shift and he called in the reserves. And he decided that the police would make their stand at the intersection of Yonge and Richmond Streets. Driving his decision was his adamant view that the financial district of Toronto had to be saved at all costs. And so he erected a picket of policemen armed with batons, as well as a barricade. The mob moved southward, the police braced for an attack that would never come. From the start, it was not the mob's intention to attack the financial district. Their target all along had been the Greek businesses along Queen Street West. And so when they came at this intersection, rather than confronting the police, they turned westward onto Queen Street in search of more Greek businesses to destroy.
The mob surges west on Queen Street, directly past City Hall. They are targeting a series of nearby Greek-owned restaurants. At 1:05 a.m., they sack the Palace Cafe, owned by John Bagus, at Queen and McCall Streets, and smash everything in sight. 5 minutes later, they loot and demolish the nearby New London Cafe at 311 Queen Street West. The owner, Eleftherios Dallas, shaken by the violence, tells reporters he has never had trouble with soldiers before and is a regular contributor to the Patriotic Fund. By 1:20 a.m., the mob demolishes the Alexandria Cafe at 748 Queen Street West. Owner Tony Tsaroff begs police to intervene, but they refuse. The mob hurls him to the ground, and he watches as his cafe is destroyed. Finally, at 1:30 a.m., 20 or 30 cars full of veterans and civilians stop outside the Sunnyside Cafe at Queen and Roncesvalles Avenue. It is owned by a naturalized Greek who has anglicized his name to George Baker. An employee tells reporters, "The crowd just came in and smashed everything. They smashed a cash register and took $200. There were 12 policemen standing outside, but they did nothing." By 2 a.m., most of the action is over. 11 restaurants owned and operated by Greeks have been smashed and looted. The damage, in today's currency, almost $1 million.
One perplexing issue about the riots on Friday night was, why didn't the police respond more aggressively to the rioters? The reason why they didn't captures a problem that beset the authorities throughout this episode, and that was one involving overlapping or conflicting jurisdictions. Very early on in the evening, the police recognized that something was afoot. We know that Acting Chief Constable Samuel Dixon sent a bevy of constables and a police inspector to the intersection of Bloor and Yonge Street to confront the crowd. We know that just before 8 o'clock, he sent a telegram to the commander of the military police at Exhibition Place, asking them to send some policemen as well to augment the civilian police. And indeed, by 9 o'clock, both civilian and military police were stationed at that intersection and could indeed have prevented the destruction of most of the restaurants that evening. But instead, they did nothing. And the reason was that there was a failure in the chain of command. The civilian police stated that they had not been given orders about what to do. The military police stated that they had authority over soldiers who were still in the armed forces, but not those who had been discharged and who were in fact civilians. And so they said, "We can do nothing unless we're attacked or until the Riot Act is read." And so they stood by and watched as the rioters destroyed the restaurants and establishments in the Yonge and Bloor Street area.
Asked to explain the night's violence, one veteran pointed to Queen's Park.
Those big fat slobs in government positions should be put out and their places filled by returned men. Is it fair that these returned heroes, some of them minus legs or arms, should be forced to beg for work, while these aliens are taking the best and living off the fat of the land?
Another veteran put it more succinctly.
Every eating place you go into, it is a case of giving your money over to foreigners.
Saturday morning, the city awoke to an uneasy peace. Mayor Tommy Church called a press conference for 10 a.m. here on the steps of City Hall. He began by assuring them that mob rule would not exist in Toronto for another hour. He then stated that while he recognized that the city had not responded with vigor the night before, should rioting erupt on this Saturday, the police would be ready.
The police were largely British. They were probably older men because a lot of the younger had enlisted. They tended to be big. They had billy clubs and they knew how to use them. And they were hated because police always are hated. And if you're a veteran, the Toronto police are the same as the military police, as the red caps that you'd put up with overseas. They were brutal. They ran military prisons that were brutal. And as far as you were concerned, the Toronto cops were just the same.
Saturday passed largely without any incidents of violence until late afternoon, when then, ominously, two cars parked in front of City Hall. No one paid them much attention. In each of the cars were groups of returned veterans in uniform. Standing on the running board of each of the cars were two buglers. Their intent soon became clear, as shortly after six, the cars set off into the city center. The buglers began to play the call to arms, and this was the prearranged signal for returned veterans to start to gather for another night of hunting Greeks.
The two cars carrying the veterans and buglers turned north at Yonge and Queen Streets. As it cruised up Yonge Street and through the surrounding neighborhood, the call to arms was having its desired effect. Veterans and returned soldiers, by the hundreds, followed the buglers north to Shrapnel Corners at College and Yonge Street, the scene of Friday night's violence.
I'm standing in front of the Court Street Police Station. It was on this site on Saturday evening that the war between the police and the rioters would begin. The mob had started to reform at Shrapnel Corners. The police, however, were ready this time. They identified the ringleaders and went into the crowd and nabbed them. They took Arthur Draymond and Ernest Haggis, two of the well-known leaders of the mob, and brought them here to the police station. The mob, however, followed the police and literally laid siege to the police station. The mob gathered here in front and demanded that the police release their comrades. This time, however, the police had a response ready. A bevy of constables emerged from that door and launched a baton charge into the crowd. The police had another surprise in store for the rioters. Previously, they had stationed mounted constables on all of the main streets around the Court Street station. At a signal, they charged the crowd from behind. Now caught between the baton charge of the pedestrian policeman and the mounted policeman, the crowd quickly found itself in dire straits. Some fell to the ground from repeated blows. Others were arrested. Many others, and anyone who could, fled and started to regroup on Yonge Street.
On Saturday night, the police were ruthless. Stung by criticism that they had done nothing to stop the rioting on Friday, on this night they overcompensated and charged into the mob with a blind fury. Fired by vengeance and adrenaline, police raged through the downtown streets, striking out indiscriminately. Even hardened newspaper reporters and many eyewitnesses were shocked by the brutality.
Crack went a policeman's baton over the head of a crippled civilian who fell with a groan to the sidewalk in a huddled heap. Willing comrades quickly picked him up and hustled him through the crowd. As they passed the other veterans on the corner, the blood from the injured man's head trickled over his tunic onto the sidewalk. It was a nasty gash. Women screamed, and veterans were seeing red now. The civilian crowd shrank back. The police charged with batons right in amongst the crippled soldiers. In a second, crutches were countering the blows of the police batons. It was a pitiful sight.
Joseph Walsh, a Toronto barrister, was an eyewitness to Saturday night's violence.
At the corner of Elm and Young at about 10 minutes after 1, a young man, about 17, came running up the street with the policeman chasing him, waving his baton. The lad was crying out, "Give me a chance, give me a chance," but the big constable didn't pay any attention. Finally, when the terrified youngster stumbled and fell, the policeman jumped on him as he lay there and beat him several times with his baton. Then he picked him up and gave him 3 or 4 violent shoves and told him to get on about his business.
Another eyewitness, Mr. J.G. McCall, told his story.
Outside in the middle of the road, near the corner of Elizabeth and Dundas, as I saw a soldier in uniform stand his ground, a policeman hit him with his baton 6 times, and at least twice after the soldier's body was lying on the ground. On the opposite side of the street, a girl dressed in pink began arguing with a policeman, probably about the constable beating up the soldier. The policeman hit her on the head 4 times, and I saw the girl fall to the sidewalk.
I'm standing in front of the station of 52nd Division of the Metropolitan Toronto Police Force here on Dundas Street. In 1918, one of the main police stations in the city was also here on Dundas Street. Not on this location, however, but adjacent to it. During the Saturday night riots, this was one of the most contested pieces of terrain in the city. Having ascertained that their colleagues, Draymond and Haggis, were not at the Court Street police station, but instead here at Dundas Street, the mob relocated and reformed here. The mayor, learning that this was an area of great tension, himself came. He parked, got onto the hood of his car, and addressed the crowd. He told them that they should cease and desist and return to their homes so that peace could be restored. Their response was to pelt him with beer bottles and rocks, as well as hurling derisions at him. Recognizing that discretion was the better part of valor, the mayor leapt off the hood of his car and retreated into the Dundas Street police station. The police then launched a baton charge to try to disperse the crowd. For the next 3 hours, the mob and the police would fight over this contested piece of terrain. On Sunday morning, Torontonians woke up to a city on the verge of conflagration. This downtown area had been largely destroyed in the previous night's fighting. Rubble littered the street, broken glass, blood. Moreover, the heat wave had resumed as temperatures were already soaring into the mid-90s. 10 o'clock, Mayor Church called another press conference, this time to explain what had happened on Saturday night. He first admitted that the police had overreacted. Some officers, and he noted in particular young and experienced men, had used their batons too freely, accounting for the literally hundreds of casualties, some of them women and children. But he reiterated that they had indeed kept the peace. He reiterated also that the city was now in lockdown. The mayor repeated that only 2 categories of people would be allowed on the streets: municipal workers cleaning up the rubble or people going to and from church. Anyone else would be subject to summary arrest. He also repeated that the civilian and the militia were now being augmented by regular military troops from Camp Borden. Tanks and trucks were now patrolling the streets of Toronto. Order would be maintained, even if it meant that Toronto would be a city under siege.
Returning Canadian soldiers had formed themselves into an influential association known as the Great War Veterans Association. Adding to the tension between police and veterans was the fact that the association happened to be holding its national convention in Toronto during the riots. Hundreds of visiting delegates took part in the rioting. And while their president, W.P. Purney, condemned the violence, one of the vice presidents commented, When returned soldiers see foreigners making money hand over fist, there is bound to be trouble.
In defiance of Mayor Church's orders, the leadership of the Great War Veterans Association called for a public rally here on the steps of City Hall. By 5 o'clock in the afternoon, close to 5,000 men had gathered here. They heard speeches. One speaker took to the stairs and explained why they had acted. He told the audience that while good men were dying on the Western Front, husky Greeks were growing rich off the fat of the land here in Toronto. Another speaker warned the citizens of Toronto that there would be no peace until the veterans' issues had been addressed. The crowd began to grow restive. Violence was in the offing. While the speeches were in progress, however, the police and the military had acted. They'd stationed tanks and troops all around the city hall. Over the speeches could be heard the sound of horses' hoofs clattering on the cobblestones of Queen Street. There, coming from the east, were the Royal Mounted Dragoons. Resplendent in their uniforms, riding astride their magnificent beasts, their white pickaxe handles glittering in the sun, the dragoons descended on the crowd. Caught between the police, the military, and now the elite force of dragoons, the crowd began to melt away. There would be no violence this evening, and indeed, the violent phase of the Toronto anti-Greek riots had come to an end.
I did experience a fair amount of discrimination because there was at that time, because Toronto was still very Anglo-Saxon. The Greeks were the most obvious foreigners around at the time, and obviously they had the restaurants, so they were sort of in view of everybody. They used to call us greasers, and I remember myself, I was in two real good fights because of discrimination. I had a fight back, which we did.
Even though I was born in Canada, I was called a DP, a JCO, which has just come over, primarily because I had a foreign-sounding name. What they called me, what they did, what they said, didn't bother me. Quite frankly, being pragmatic, this wasn't a damn thing I could do about it. They outnumbered me. So I just nodded my head and went on my merry way.
In this kind then of climate of anti-immigrant sentiments, immigrants started thinking very actively on how to form associations to defend themselves and protect themselves from this tide of anti-foreign sentiments.
Under leadership of men such as Gus Letteros, Nick Panos, and Nick Kelimanis, the Greek community immediately contacted their relevant political officials.
The Greek community's strategy was to take action on three fronts. First, they appealed to the public, then to the legal system, and finally to Ottawa and the international arena. They started by launching a public relations campaign, stating their fervent support for Canada and the Allied cause.
The strategy was to convince the public that the Greeks can assimilate, that indeed they have assimilated. They were businessmen who posed no threat whatsoever to the political system.
In a letter to the Toronto Star, Greek Consul General K.P. Tsolenos, writing from Ottawa, said, "Americans view the Toronto riots as nothing less than an insult to Greece itself. We are one with you Canadians," he stated, and went on to encourage the isolation or expulsion of any Greeks in Canada who showed signs of pro-Germanism. "For they are not true Greeks, they are traitors. But do not condemn the lot for the sake of a few." Nick Spiliotis, known as Nick Spiel, reminded the good citizens that there were more than 2,000 Greeks in the Canadian Army, with a large percentage from Toronto. "Naturally, we were all very surprised when the riots began," he stated. "We do not believe the sensible people of Canada approve such acts." Spiel himself came to Toronto in 1908 and returned to Greece in 1912 to fight with the army against the Bulgarians. He was wounded three times before returning to Canada.
In March 1919, the Greek community had its day in court. Sitting before Justice Rose, the attorney for the Greek community put forward their case.
J.C. Walsh, attorney for the Greek businessmen, was seeking damages from the city of approximately $1 million in today's currency. He argued that as taxpayers, his clients had a right to expect the police to protect their property. And since the police had failed to do so, the city should pay compensation. Predictably, the city's attorney saw things differently. He argued that while the city was obligated by law to pay for a police force, if that police force failed to do its job, it wasn't the fault of the city, but rather the fault of the police administrators. Citing legal precedents, he argued that the city should bear no financial responsibility for the actions or inactions of the police force. After due deliberation, Justice Rose found in favor of the city. He dismissed the Greek claim and furthermore ordered the Greek merchants to pay the court costs. If the Greeks wanted compensation, it was clear they weren't going to get it from the city. They decided to look elsewhere.
The third avenue they explored was to seek compensation, not at the municipal level, but at the level of the Dominion. Reasoning that, since so much of the damage had been done by returned veterans, and since they were members of the armed forces under the jurisdiction of the government in Ottawa, Ottawa should pay.
In February of 1919, the Greek Consul General in Montreal sent a letter to the British government. He asked Britain's newly appointed colonial secretary, Alfred Milner, for financial compensation. Milner quickly tossed the issue back to Canada, specifically to the Governor General, Victor Cavendish, the 9th Duke of Devonshire, who in turn tossed it to Ottawa's Minister of Justice, Charles Doherty. Here it stopped for 2 years. Finally, after repeated letters from the Greek Consul General, Doherty submitted a report to the Committee of the Privy Council. Doherty had concluded that the Toronto riots were not really directed at the Greek community. And furthermore, all the relevant levels of government had responded to the violence with due diligence and were therefore not accountable. As for the conduct of the soldiers, Doherty referenced a principle of international law, which stated that a government could not be held responsible for the action of its soldiers if those actions were not taken under direct orders. The government was off the hook. The Privy Council accepted the report, and Ottawa duly notified the Greeks that no compensation would be forthcoming. Still, the Greeks gave it one last try.
In 1922, the Greeks tried again. When Winston Churchill, a well-known Philhellene, was appointed to be the new colonial secretary, they took the opportunity to petition directly to him. He then contacted the governor general and yet again petitioned for a court of inquiry. Even Churchill failed to receive a response, and so the case of the Greeks for compensation lay there. No financial compensation would be ever paid to the Greek merchants whose businesses were destroyed during the violent days of August.
Not only did the victims of the violence receive no compensation, even the perpetrators got off light. Of the 15 accused, all were charged with disturbing the peace and assaulting the police. In other words, no one was even charged with the destruction of what would be today more than $1 million worth of damage. And of those 15 accused, 4 were acquitted. Only 2 veterans received the stiffest sentence, 1 year in prison and a $30 fine. Clearly, in the matter of the Toronto riots, the courts considered order much more valuable than individual rights. The public's opinion, however, was of 2 viewpoints. The mainstream viewpoint was that expressed by Mayor Tommy Church in a number of his speeches. Yes, he said, the veterans did have some legitimate grievances against resident aliens like the Greeks, But rioting and unlawfulness were not the ways to address those grievances. There were others, however, like MP Thomas Foster, who simply stated that the Greeks had gotten what they deserved. In a speech to the Masonic Lodge in East York, he blamed the riots on those husky Greeks who are walking around the city with millions of dollars in their pockets. Both these viewpoints, however, shared a common theme. They suggested that Toronto's Greek and alien communities were, in part, themselves responsible for the August riots.
Given the overwhelming anti-immigrant sentiment in the public, any incident involving a Greek immigrant and a breaching of a cultural norm could mean a violent crowd reaction against the Greeks. So the point here is that even one individual committed an act that did not conform with the norms of the society, it was the whole Greek community of the area that would pay the price for this individual nonconformity.
I think the riots in Toronto against the Greeks in 1918 are probably something that could have happened against any ethnic group. I think you have to realize that Canada was in a state of national grievance by 1918. Farmers felt they were screwed and hated the people in the city. French hated English Canadians and vice versa. East hated West. Women were still pressing for the popular vote to be given to them permanently. Women were also pushing for prohibition, which offended veterans because they wanted a drink, thank you very much. Labor was fighting with capital. Strikes had been banned by the government in 1918, and so if you were a labor union, you felt you were being hard done by. Veterans hated the government for the way it was treating them. Conscripts hated the government for calling them up. People who'd volunteered hated conscripts. Nobody liked the cops. Nobody was living well in good housing except the rich, and everybody hated the rich.
It is then this climate of fear, intimidation, persecution that in many ways fed to racial animosities against Greek immigrants specifically, and also immigrants from southeastern Europe.
The memory of the rioting that took place in Toronto during the violent days of August 1918 quickly passed both amongst the Greek community and Canadian society at large. There were a number of reasons why this was so. First, the announcement of the armistice and the ending of the First World War in November quickly overshadowed the events of August. In the euphoria of the ending of the war, everyone was so anxious to put what had gone on behind them. Secondly, there was a conscious decision taken by the leadership of the Greek community to try to distance themselves from those events. What they wanted to do was to mainstream Greek society into Canadian society. And so remembering events like the anti-Greek riots was antithetical to that stance.
Well, yeah, as far as my dad's concerned, I don't think he was bitter. I don't recall him being bitter or talking against the English people or anything like that. He accepted it as this was part of life, and that's the way it was then, and he went on from there.
Another reason the Toronto riots were quickly forgotten was that Canadians had uncovered a more disturbing evil in their midst. Since before the war, labor discontent had been growing in Canada and the United States. 1919 brought violent strikes, most prominently in Winnipeg, and alarming talk of socialism. Out of this social turmoil, Canadians fashioned a new scapegoat, socialists and Bolsheviks from Eastern Europe. The Greeks, who already stood out as small business owners, were still viewed as foreigners, but at least they weren't leftists and communists.
Greek immigrants in the United States, as well as in Canada, were seen by the dominant white Anglo society as exemplary immigrants. They were willing to assimilate, they were willing to die for the nation, they were demonstrating that they can be successful in business. In the public imagination now, the Greek was not the undesirable scum of Europe as he was known in the 1910s and 20s. So we can say that the assimilation politics in the 1920s paid a great deal of dividends for Greeks later than 1930s and 1940s.
In spite of the fact that this episode did pass from collective popular memory, it is important that we learn its lessons. It is easy during a period of crisis for mainstream society to look for scapegoats, look for usually minority groups to blame for the plight of mainstream society. In 1918, the Greeks were the lightning rod for such resentment.
And so we have come from street riots in 1918 to street parties today. Toronto's Greek community can truly celebrate an amazing passage. Indeed, having grown up in an era of multiculturalism, young Greek Canadians may find it hard to believe that the racism and violence of August 1918 ever really happened. But as we proudly celebrate our ethnic diversity, it's worth remembering what our ancestors endured just for the right to be called Canadians.
Και για σένα φως μου ειστερήθηκα.